Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Astute Law Listen Up podcast. And today I've got the pleasure of welcoming back Dr. Iain Price. How are you doing, Iain?
I'm doing well, Sosh. You?
I'm good. You know, Iain, we set up this podcast to discuss something that you and I did together, which was called the Harrison Report. And I thought that would be really useful for, our clients, the audience, people, employers, managers, entrepreneurs, to sort of see what this report's about. There's so many self-assessment reports out there, it's just like a sea of them. But this one I found to be quite different. And what I found with the self-exploration or exploration with you, actually, you really start to uncover things about yourself that will then perhaps give you a different perspective and allow you to handle challenging things in a much different way. So before we get into that report, Iain, anybody that's not seen our podcast before or seen you before, I know you've done quite a few things. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Why should anybody listening to this be listening to you about this type of assessment?
Okay, well, I'm a neuroscientist by training. That's where I have a PhD in, and I work subsequently as a coach, trainer, and consultant with everything with the brain in mind. I work with elite athletes, Paralympians, Olympians. I work with CEOs, CEOs, COOs. I work with entrepreneurs, heads of department, NHS, right across the board, other government issue, initiatives, really. I've worked with the BBC, all sorts of things, really. So I have about 25 years of experience of knowing how and applying how people think and understanding of the brain, how people communicate both internally here, but also with other people's brains. And that's really very much then about individual leadership. So that's leadership of yourself and then leadership of other people. Of course, that then leads on to team development. So I'm very much part of that. And I love doing all sorts of those kind of works with people, the one-to-one to the one-to-many. So yeah, that's kind of my background in a nutshell, I suppose.
And I love it. You know, when we talk both during our podcast and when we're offline, understanding the way the mind ticks and why people behave the way they do and how they think. I mean, you get that. You really are unstoppable if you can just uncover those things or unravel those things that are kind of holding you back. But anyway, let's go straight into the Harrison report.
Sure.
We did this a little while before. And perhaps, first of all, you could tell the audience, how is it that people will benefit? Who does it benefit, the Harrison report, and how does it do?
Yes. Very good. Well, in theory, the Harrison assessment process will benefit anybody that's curious about how their brain ticks, how they are, who they are, and why they do the things that they do, and maybe some things that they're just not aware of. I mean, it's about identifying, as you said, sort of derailers, things that are in your blind spot. And, you and I have done the Johari window. If anybody's listening to this has done that, the unknown unknowns. And I think that's particularly what Harrison's very good at revealing for people. You've mentioned that. But I would say in particular, I think Harrison suits people who are our leaders, are entrepreneurs, and also anybody that's got any responsibility within the HR and recruiting people, engagement and retention within a team, so it's more about leaders and teamwork, really. That's what I think, because it's all about how people interact.
How is it because those types of people more than others?
Okay. So it's probably helpful to sort of say there's two main theories that Harrison addresses. So this Harrison assessment's come out of this guy called Dan Harrison, who set it up about 30 years ago. And he bases the idea that we have two theories in play that we need to look at when we talk about our performance, really, and our enjoyment in performance. And funnily enough, the first theory is enjoyment performance theory. And the idea is that the more you enjoy doing something, the more you do it, the better the feedback you get. The better the feedback you get, the better you do that thing, and then the more you enjoy doing it. So it's a feedback loop. But it's important to say the opposite is true as well, because if you don't enjoy something, you don't tend to do it, certainly within work. If you have task preferences that you don't really want to do, well, of course, you don't do it as much. Exactly. Put them off, don't get the feedback, and you don't get better at it. So that's the first theory, enjoyment performance theory. And the second theory, which I think it makes this particular assessment tool very, very different from anything else that I've come across since or before or since, actually. And that's the paradox theory. The idea that there are some inherent truths about some statements that we make, like tough love, less is more, which are paradoxes. I mean, how can that be true? Those are two opposing sort of forces, if you like. And what Harrison does is Dan Harrison looks at 175 traits So traits are all sorts of things, like, you know, taking initiative, how you deal with stress, to how you communicate with people. But then also he uses 12 paradoxical pairs that we look at. And again, we might share one of those graphs. In fact, your graph, which you very kindly said that you like would share.
I think I don't want to let myself in for it. Yeah, so we're going to use that as an example, because it's difficult to get your head around, isn't it? Because I'm expecting it just to say, right, you're this or you're that. And what it comes out with, it says two opposite things, which are not actually conflicting, as odd as that sentence sounds.
Absolutely. So tough love, a good example, if any of you are parents that are listening, you know the importance and benefit of having the toughness, right? But if you're just tough on your own, you're going to be a tyrant. And if you have the love on its own, well, then you might just be a bit wishy-washy and your kids won't have boundaries. And it's the same thing if you're leading a team. So the main thing about the paradoxical pairing is that it's actually strengthening both of those qualities, those traits, if you like, that gives you what we call balanced versatility. I think the other thing, just before we go on to show the charts, is to show to say this. You know, one of the things that can be really difficult as an employer, as a leader, is really understanding what motivates people to stay within the role.
Yeah,
and it doesn't tend to be money, or at least it's not only money. And again, Harrison assessment, if you share it in the right way within teams, what I find is that it really helps teams to understand, okay, why am I really doing the role that I'm doing? Am I really enjoying it? Because if I'm enjoying it, then I'm more likely to get some success out of it. And the other part of that is then to allow individuals within the team to take responsibility for their own progression, because we can match what we call job success formally. So the idea is, over 30 years of research and thousands of case studies, we can look and go, okay, what traits best match this person for their development into a certain role? So again, you can help keep talent rather than lose talent inadvertently, because you've not really understood why that person wants to stay with you or what it is that they want to do in terms of progress their career. And of course, quite often, your employee or the person that you're leading may not know that either. And again, this is where Harrison's really, really useful, because you can have this sort of dovetail approach, if you like, leader come employer working with the employee. And together you get a very powerful combination. And bearing in mind, you know, losing talent is going to cost, I think, on average, £13,000 for every employee in the UK, at least. And, you know, that's a tremendous amount to be considering. That's before all of the sort of fallout that you might get because animosity, you know, bad working, you know, vibes and all that sort of stuff that you would get. And as an employment lawyer, you know all about this, right?
Yeah, so, I was just thinking as you were talking there, Iain, you know, the amount of problems that would be evaded if people just went a couple of layers deeper into understanding what motivated people, you know, and it's not just the money, you know, maybe from the employee's point of view is, well, I paid him, you know, and from the employee's, well, like, oh God, it's Monday, I've got to go to work, clock in, clock out.
And I've told him, yep.
That
and the
purpose,
other thing is
that lack of fulfillment. And you know, I did something with my staff, you know, I don't know if I mentioned it to you before, and I got them all to write their bucket list a couple of years ago. And what happens is at Christmas, on the years, I try and tick off one or two things of the might be simple things, maybe, you know, going to a certain place, that's not so much happening now, or doing, you know, doing a yoga course was one of them, for example, stuff like that. And when there's a feeling that somebody's got your back because you've looked at what actually motivates them, that drives loyalty, and also you're in the same direction, that drives productivity and all those things. So these are for people, this isn't for everybody, this is for somebody that actually wants to create a culture or create a company where everybody is really with drive and purpose to whatever that direction is, right?
Absolutely. It's I to the power of we, which is our friend Angie Jenkins will say, you know, what happens is when you identify kind of what are other people's needs, what are their drivers in life, then you can start to meet those. And as you start to meet those, they obviously start to meet yours. And this is what elevates us to high performance teams. You know, people say, you know, how do I get a high performance team? It's not about silos. It's about actually being a team that's been joined up. So absolutely, you know, understanding where you're going to get more than the sort of standard effort that somebody's been contracted to. If you want discretionary effort, you know, you want people to run through walls for you, well, this is how you do it.
Yep. Let's dive in, Iain. Let's have a look.
Yeah, absolutely. Shall I share? So look, obviously the other thing to say is that there are so many different reports that we can pull out. So it's not just one or two, we can, and then we'll maybe sort of tie up with that. So, but this is the main paradoxical pairing that we thought would be good to share with you. And this is Tosh, and he has said it's okay to share it.
You're making me nervous now, Ian. You're making me nervous.
So the key thing with Harrison is that it's always about the definition to the trait, because if you're not careful, you can think, well, you know, risking, for instance, is on one axis here. Anybody's used to matrices will sort of understand this graph probably pretty quickly. But, you know, risking, that's not like bungee jumping and throwing yourself out of an airplane, although you might do that. This is about, again, if you read the definition, it's the tendency to feel comfortable with business ventures and involve uncertainty. So that's on, and we call the y-axis as risking. That tends to be the more outgoing, aggressive trait, if you like. And then the x-axis, analyzing pitfalls, tends to be the sort of supporting trait, the sort of more nurturing trait. And then what we get with analyzing pitfalls is just saying that's the tendency to scrutinize potential difficulties related to a plan or strategy. And this represents Tosh very kindly. Thank you, Tosh, for sharing that. And then what we see is that if we plot where Tosh is based on his scores on his questionnaire, which only took you, what, 15, 20 minutes online to answer those questions, we get this plot, which puts you within this quadrant, the top right-hand quadrant, which we call mindful courage. And this means that people who have this balance, because there's balance both in the risking and the trait of analyzing pitfalls, which gives you balance versatility, which puts you in this mindful courage place, which is the ability to really analyze potential pitfalls, but actually not being too afraid for actually taking initiative. And this the strategy paradox, the strategic paradox, is one that's really prevalent in entrepreneurs, leaders, people who have set up their own businesses, which is really interesting, right, Tosh? Because that's you.
I mean, this is what I do for a living. So, I mean, I was really pleased to see this. But what do we do with it, Ian? Somebody sees these things here. I appreciate this is a strength quality for me. There'll be some negative ones as well. But whether it's good or bad, what do we do with this information? How do you help us with this?
So the main thing I find when we run a imbalance paradox is to have a look at, okay, how this has helped you historically leverage your sort of skill set, your traits, to be, you know, successful and to enjoy the role that you do. Because actually understanding that particularly is useful if somebody then wants to change certain aspects of their, you know, their profile. And the key thing is that Harrison doesn't say, you know, it's not like a personality thing, it's about behavior. And behavior we can all change. And if it's okay, I'll share all of your paradoxes together, if that's all right.
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay.
Yeah, I want people to see the benefit of this.
Okay, it's very, very generous of you. So you can see here, I mean, I'll try and put all of the paradoxes on so that you can actually see all the paradoxes together. So the 12 paradoxes, and they're split into columns. So the columns go from interpersonal to achievement to leadership. And that's very much about how we have these balanced traits or not, going from the individual, the interpersonal, through to how you lead. And then I love this because the rows then split that further. If you go down, it's initiating. How do you initiate that? So the first paradoxical pairing is opinions. So how you make up your mind, how do you make decisions? And then you go to motivating. Well, how do you motivate yourself and other people? How do you implement it within your team? And then how do you maintain it within your team? And actually working with teams a lot, I think one of the things that people forget is that maintenance part. You know, they see a project and you think, right, okay, we've got to get to that project and we've hit that KPI or that target, whatever it is that we've made that sale, whatever it might be. And then forget actually it's about maintenance of the team, maintenance of that client, maintenance of that contract. And the main thing here is that you can sort of see the plots. And then the main plots are the little red dots with the general range of behavior in that sort of shaded area. But you may also see that, well, two things really. Firstly, actually, Tosh, you're pretty well balanced in a lot of things. Nobody's entirely balanced. All the Chris. But here's a good example. I mean, so communication is a very good example. If you look at that one as a paradox comparing, let's make it slightly bigger. So communication, what this says is that if we plot your scores, it's saying your diplomacy, so diplomatic, the ability to sort of put things, you know, sensitively and caringly and understanding somebody else. With frankness, it says that actually, you know, the score for diplomatic is actually possibly on the 5, which actually for Harrison is slightly under the trait because it's an accelerated score. It's from the 6 is the trait, actually. And then Frank can be really, really high. It's 9. And what this means is that on your good day, you could be in this forthright diplomacy section, but on a not so good day, you could come across as being blunt. Well, what's the unintended consequence of being blunt for your team, for your clients?
I guess the idea of being blunt is to get to the point, or, you know, pick a team, make a decision. Yeah.
So there you go. So I think this is great. That's a great example, Sitosh, because actually for you, you're having clarity and you're, what's the problem? I'm telling you what I need, when I need it. Right? Yeah, of course, for some other people, that doesn't land well. No. And the consequence of that is, actually, I'm quite scared of him. I don't really, he doesn't really understand me, doesn't really get me. And that can be an issue. So one of the things, again, when I work with clients as a coach, and they say, okay, what are the things that we could put in place? What things could you change? What things could you start doing, stop doing, or maybe continue doing, so that you can sort of edge slightly into that sort of forthright diplomacy, which is that, actually, how can I look at diplomacy? And when I've worked with people who have struggle to understand how people tick emotionally with EQ, and I've worked with all sorts of people with autism and Asperger's as well on this, there are some things that we can do to help get around that, if you like, to help people think and feel that you're being diplomatic and care for them. Now, the other thing that's present in this is a little, you'll see these little vortexes, and these are the emotional flips. The emotional flips that we get. So we get two types. We get an aggressive type, which is the red, and we get the sort of more passive, which is the sort of blacky gray vortex.
Yeah.
And what this says is that, you know, sometimes if you are under stress, Tosh, under the communication, you can sort of almost just resign responsibility. Now, I've told you what I think. That's it. If you're not listening, I'm just going to step out of it. And the problem with emotional flips, and we all have emotional flips, by the way, is that they're emotional. So they don't tend to be from a best place in terms of how our brain works to make, how do I say this, consistent, you know, well thought out decisions. And also it does tend to take it out of you as well, because it's an emotional reaction, and emotions cost. And the other problem with emotions is that other people react emotionally to them. So the other thing that Harrison does for a leader here is to go, okay, what are my blind spots? What are the unintended consequences of my, say, communication style, or the way in which I delegate? You know, where are my emotional flips as well? You know, where are they? How can I best help myself? So a good example for one that I work a lot with leaders is the motivation paradox, because part of that is how you deal with stress. So stress management, actually, in this case, is two traits it's put together, which is how you deal with stress at work. Those are how do you have stress downtime, you know?
Yes.
And actually, this says that you look after yourself, Tosh. But I have to say, particularly at the moment with COVID times, there's a lot of people in this stress achievement, you know, stress management has gone out the window to a certain extent. And then they are in this place, which we know stress achievement tends to lead to burnout. So one of the benefits, again, of this is, look, it's a diagnostic tool that's predictive of how you're going to behave if we don't change. And again, that's, I would say, with coaching with me, you know, we can work through that so that that's less likely to happen. In fact, turning the negatives potentially into positives, I mean, which is going to be great for you.
Sorry, Iain,
that's going to be great.
Interesting.
For you.
I found the whole process very interesting when we went through it. And, you know, you really took your time with it as well, going through it together with me to figure out how we could use those things. We can close the screen now. So in reality, it's who is it that will benefit, and what is the benefits that businesses would see as a result of this, or whether even as an individual?
Yeah.
You know,
so the return on investment basically is, you're less likely to lose team members and talent. You're going to retain them. You're going to have a healthier and more enjoyable work environment. There's going to be that beyond, you know, what you're contracted to do in terms of effort. So it's going to be that discretionary effort. You're going to have a far more integrated way in which you are working together as a team. So that leads to mental health, fitness, well-being, all of those sort of benefits, which, if you don't address them, and when I see this not being addressed, oh my goodness, how people pay. And it's so frustrating to me as somebody who does this kind of work, because particularly leaders can be really reticent to this, because I think, oh, I'm going to be labeled, I'm going to be put in a box. For me, it's not about that. It's about, if you want to be a high performing, happy, healthy, functioning, surviving team, then you understand your relative strengths and weaknesses. When you do that, then you can start operating as a team.
It's not far off a marriage, is it? Or a relationship?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, how are you going to make that work? It's not going to be by not going deeper or really understanding that person or what their wants and needs are, is it?
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's just a relationship otherwise.
And I think, like a relationship, I mean, it's about the great thing about the tool actually is that there are many things that we haven't spoken about. You know, you can do sort of a career navigation report. What sort of things, if I'm in HR, do I need to be aware of that this person needs going forwards? And L&D, you know, there's ways in which we can sort of share the information, which is GDPR compliant, which allows us to say, okay, this is an issue for you in your workplace. You need to be start thinking about either communication or decision approach or strategic acumen, or how you know, where the power of relationships are, you know, how you delegate, all of these things come into play. And I think the last bit is, you know, you can use this to look at, you know, recruiting. So you can actually, there's ways in which you can take at hundreds of people, less than I think is about $1 each, roughly. You know, look at the eligibility first for a role, and then you can look at the suitability as well for your team. And the way in which we do that, we sort of funnel that, and we can help you through it. You can identify that with a special role. So again, it's around the role, which again, from a sort of an employer point of view, I think is great. Again, thinking legally, because it's not necessarily about the person, though it is, it's about building the right role and then allowing, when that person's onboarded, you can then have, they've already started with you've been taken on with this role. We understand these are the things that you want to work on. You know, that's already your appraisal sorted. So you don't need, you know, in many ways,
the foundation for small right businesses. At the start. It's going to significantly increase the chances of getting it right. Iain, thank you so much for that. Really helpful walkthrough, in fact, on what that Harrison report is. You know how this works. Your contact details will go out with this podcast. So anybody that's watching this, if there's something that's of interest to you, if you're running a business, or as an individual, you're looking for self-exploration, or a manager, entrepreneur, whatever your scenario is, you know, please contact Iain. He's super helpful guy, super intelligent, and one of the nicest people I know as well. So if you just get in touch with him, he'll be able to talk you through how this can help you and your business moving forward. Dr. Iain Price, thank you very much again, as always. Everybody, thank you for watching, and see you again soon. Bye for now.
Bye.